Good morning, church. Welcome, welcome, welcome to worship. I hope that your heart is open, that you are ready to hear from God. Because if we have our hearts open and we listen, God will speak to us. He is in the midst. Where two or more are gathered, he is in the midst. So Jesus is here. Thanks be to God. Will you watch the screens for this morning's announcements?
Church. Starting point is today in the gym. It is a luncheon for people new to Dayton United Methodist Church. Come on, let me show you to the gym. Please come and let us honor you. It is a great way to get connected with others here at the church. It is a great time to eat cookies too. Just join us today after the 11 o'clock service in the gym. Baptism Sunday is on August 23rd. Anyone interested in being baptized should contact the church office. Parents of interested children should talk to our children's director, Teresa Cornell. I wonder how this thing goes together. Please be praying for the Overhaul Youth Group as they leave for their mission trip this Saturday. Please pray for safety, for effective service, and for spiritual growth. While we are talking about prayer, on Friday, August 7th at 6:30, we are going to have a prayer meeting for our nation. Please note we've had to change the date. Please, church, join us as we unite together in praying for our country on Friday, August 7th at 6:30. Have a great week, church.
Praise God. All right. A priest is an intermediary. The office of priest is someone who represents God to the people and represents the people to God. Jesus is our great high priest. Amen? Amen. He brings God to us and he brings us to God. And the scripture says that Jesus is a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. And that's what we're going to be looking at today. The You Ask For It question was about Melchizedek and who he is in the Bible. So let's worship the God who sent us the great high priest, his son, Jesus Christ. Amen? Will you please stand and sing our opening hymn, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
All hail the power of Jesus' name, let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Ye chosen seed of Israel's race, ye ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saved you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saved you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. Let every kindred, every tribe, on this terrestrial ball, to him all majesty ascribe, and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe, and crown him Lord of all. Oh, that with yonder sacred throng we at his feet may fall, we'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. We'll join me, everlasting song, and crown him Lord of all.
You may be seated.
If you have a praise or a prayer concern, Frank's at the back with a microphone. We invite you to step back there and share your name and your praise or prayer request. Anybody have a praise or a prayer concern today?
Morning, Pastor Mike. I'm Paulette Oderio. I'd just like prayer for my sister Carol and her daughter Casey. They are having some fairly serious relationship struggles.
All right. All right. Any others? Good. I don't see anybody else moving to the microphone. On our church prayer list this morning, we're giving thanks. Jason Brewer had successful cataract surgery this week. Kat Bauer's father, Keith Merrill, will have cancer surgery on the 21st. I want to pray for him. The youth are leaving on the 25th. That's this Saturday to go to Camp Lakewood for a mission trip through Wednesday the 29th. So please pray for them. Pray that everybody's safe, but pray that they give their lives away and learn in the serving what God wants them to learn and grow as they share together in that. And then, of course, let's pray for our nation. We know our nation needs prayer desperately. So want to do that. We're going to sing a prayer hymn and open our hearts to God's presence. And you know that if you would like to pray at the altar during the prayer time, during this hymn and the prayer time that follows, come and pray and someone will come and pray with you. The prayer hymn this morning is Abide With Me. I invite you to stand if you're able and let's sing.
Shadows gleam in life and death.
Please be seated and join me in prayer. God, together with the Apostle Paul, we proclaim today, O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? There is no power in death for those who put their faith and trust in the risen one, in Jesus Christ, our Lord. And so we come to this worship service. We come to you in prayer, trusting in Jesus, believing in Jesus, filled with Jesus. And we come in confidence, knowing that you abide with us every moment of every day, in the good and the bad, in the challenging and the comforting, in every experience of life, you are with us. And so, God, we are never alone. Father, you know that sometimes we feel lonely. Sometimes our minds tell us that you are gone or that you're a million miles away or that we're alone, but it's not true. For you have promised, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for being with us. And Father, I pray that you would help us live our lives in confidence and joy, knowing that you are with us. God, help us show Jesus to others because Jesus is in us. And I pray that you would move us beyond the challenges and the difficulties of life and help us to praise you, to thank you, to live for you, to honor you in every way. Let people see Jesus in me, Lord, and let them be drawn to him. God, thank you that we can pray for one another in the body of Christ. We pray for Paulette's sister, Carol, and her daughter, Casey, and we pray, God, that you would send reconciliation to them. Help them, Lord, remember how much they love each other. And whatever pain, whatever disagreement, whatever has gone between them, that has them in relationship difficulty, we pray, God, let love overcome it. And Father, we pray the same thing for all of the relationships we have in our own families, in our own friendships, in our own neighborhoods, where there is brokenness, where there is conflict. God, would you send reconciliation and peace? And would you help us to be peacemakers the very best we can? God, we thank you that Jason Brewer had successful cataract surgery, heal up his eye completely, and restore his vision completely, we ask. We pray for Kat Bauer's dad, Keith. We ask you to prepare him in every way for the surgery that's coming up. We pray, God, that you would guide the surgical team, the doctor, the anesthesiologist, the nurses. We pray, Father, that there will be no complications or infection. And we pray that the surgery will accomplish its work. And then, Lord, pour out your healing in Keith's body. Touch him, Jesus. God, we pray for our youth as they go on a mission trip next weekend. We pray that you'll keep them safe on the trip there and back and as they interact and work shoulder to shoulder with one another. And we ask, God, that you pour out your blessing to the camp through them and pour out your blessing to them as they serve. And grow them deep. Be with every adult leader who goes along on the trip and give them your stamina and strength and joy and give them grace, Lord. Give them a deep, deep love for the students and let it show. God, we pray for our nation. We pray against the divisiveness of our nation. We pray, God, that people would begin to understand in the depths of their soul that you don't have to demonize somebody because we disagree with each other. I pray, God, that you would work in our political system where there is great partisanship and that you would raise up statesmanship, raise up people who are willing to set aside their own personal agendas for the good of the nation. Raise up those kind of leaders. God, we pray for our own community and we pray, God, that you would pour out your blessing and healing. And we pray for those who have been affected by COVID-19. And especially, God, for those who have lost loved ones to this pandemic. We pray for reconciliation racially, Lord, in our nation. And where there is racism, we pray, God, root it out. Where there is prejudice, root it out, especially, God, among us, your people. If there's any way that we fail you in our relationships with others, God, change our minds, change our hearts, make us like Jesus. Father, we love you and we commit to you this worship service, our church, its ministries. We commit to you our lives and our families, and we pray that you would help us leave this place today on fire for Jesus and help us live our lives in victory. God, we ask these things in the name and authority of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. We'll sing one more hymn before the message. Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. I invite you to stand if you're able.
Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Much we need thy tender care. In thy pleasant pastures feed us, for our use thy folds prepare. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us, thine we are. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us, thine we are. We are thine, now thus be friends. Guardian of our way, keep thy flock from sin, defend us, seek us when we go astray. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, hear, oh, hear us when we pray. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, hear, oh, hear us when we pray. Thou hast promised to receive us, poor and sinful though we be. Thou hast mercy to relieve us, grace to cleanse and power to free. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, we will early turn to thee. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus,
just before my message this morning, we have a message from Guatemala. Les Peters has sent a video, and I want to show it to you this morning with an update on Impact Ministries, our mission partner in Guatemala. Will you watch the screens, please?
It gives me great joy to greet all of you in Dayton United Methodist Church from the Central Highlands of Guatemala. Our connection with you has gone way back to about 2014 when Dr. Chris and Rachel Brandenburg came to serve the first time. And then more recently, your church has been sending short-term missions teams our way. And It was such a pleasure to have Pastor Mike and Shirley here with us and to just see and take part in what the Lord is doing in our part of the world. Of course, the COVID situation has prevented the most recent team from coming our way. So what we wanted to do this morning is just give you a brief update on what has been happening here. Rita and I have been serving here for the last 20 years.
We are just so grateful for the way the Lord has blessed beyond what we could have thought or imagined when we first came to Guatemala. We now have 10 schools in operation and they are serving 1,600 children. Each one of those students receives a meal every day. That comes to about 8,000 meals per week, counting the staff. And it's just such a blessing in a country where the average amount of education is 4.25 years. Many of our students are going well beyond that and into university. We've also had the opportunity to open a medical clinic. In that medical clinic, we have two staff members on, and they're serving the families of our children and our churches. We've had the opportunity to plant 3 churches, see 2 of the nationals ordained as pastors, and the churches are growing. Such an appetite for the Lord in this country. We're just so excited about that. Part of our vision and our plan right from the outset had to do with sustainability, where instead of creating a permanent dependence on North American funds, the Guatemalans themselves would be able to begin generating funds and working to sustain the operating costs of the ministry. And out of that has come our whole agricultural project, and we have now planted over 20,000 coffee plants, looking to the future of harvesting coffee and planting many vegetables. Those vegetables in turn are being used in each one of our school kitchens throughout the week.
A very exciting part of the ministry is our baby house, or our children's home, that we have begun. And we're just thrilled that even during this COVID time, things are actually on the up there. We have 11 children as of yesterday that we are caring for. And every one of these children, they come with an incredibly sad story. We have several babies that came to us the day after they were born. And they were born, both, there were 2 boys, different times that came. They both have a schizophrenic mom who is a prostitute and lives on the street and wanted nothing to do with the child she bore. And we have these 2 beautiful, beautiful boys living in our home. And we have a little girl that was left where the buses stop. Newborn baby girl left in a corner. Right where the buses have the interchange. Beautiful, beautiful little girl. She's already now over a month old. She came to us just as soon as she was born. We have a little girl who is the result of a gang rape, and she's in danger. She's in danger were she to go back to where she came from, because those men, they are there. They're there and they want her. They want to do her harm, I believe, and we want to keep her. And she's been with us for 9 months already. We have a little boy who is also the result of a rape. And his mother has never loved him, never treated him well. He's so, so abused. And we just have him for a little while, but we're helping him get better. He's already 6 years old, but he can't speak. He's still in diapers. We're helping him. We're helping him. And praise God, he's allowing us to be able to help each of these children and to love them and just to pour out love upon them and give them what they need in order to be well. We have a group of nannies that during this whole COVID time have moved in, and they are staying here full time because we didn't want them going and coming and bringing that, possibly that virus, to the home. So they have moved in and they're living there and taking care of those children, and with so much love, with so much joy, serving God through this baby home. And we're just so thankful for that opportunity.
The Lord has been so good, giving us many opportunities to reach out and show His love and His light into this dark part of the world. We're just so blessed when we see people seeing Him in the middle of all of this and turning to Him, finding hope in Christ. During this COVID time, so many things are limited. We have no short-term missions teams here right now. And everything is locked down here on this property. We have our services on Sunday with the people who are locked down here on this property, but we're broadcasting as best as we can. Many people don't have internet. And schools, of course, have been ordered closed. We're looking for them to open in the next short while. We don't know when that will be. In the meantime, our staff are handing out food hampers to these families. And in this country, if you don't have work, you don't eat. And many people, especially single moms, single dads with families, are going through such horrific times right now. Thank you so much for the support that you've given to the nutrition program and this crisis relief that we're giving to these many needy families right now. Thank you for your prayer, for your support all these years. Thank you so much for standing with us. We know that God is answering prayer. And in the middle of challenges and difficulties, the Lord is showing Himself strong. And we just have the privilege of being here and serving on your behalf. Thank you for your prayers, your support, and your encouragement. God bless you.
Missionaries have to adapt, and just like we've all had to adapt to COVID, they've adapted in Guatemala as well. Can't wait to go back there next year and see what God has done in the meantime. Before I begin the message this morning, I want to say a word about the word Melchizedek. It's a CH in the middle. It can be pronounced like it's a K. It can be pronounced like it's the CH. Or probably in Hebrew, it's more likely that it's Melchizedek because they have that, there's a pronunciation of a CH that almost is like clearing your throat. I'm not going to do that all through the message today. I'm just going to do Melchizedek. And if you prefer a different pronunciation, hear that when I say Melchizedek, okay? Here we go. Genesis chapter 14, verses 18 through 20. Then Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. He was priest of God Most High, and he blessed Abram, saying, "Blessed be Abram by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth. And praise be to God Most High, who delivered your enemies into your hand." Then Abram gave him a tenth of everything. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. Let's pray together. God, open our minds and hearts to the figure and to understand Melchizedek and why he's in the scripture and how he points to Jesus. And I just pray, God, that we would draw closer to our great high priest in this service and that Jesus would go with us from this place and be the go-between, between us and you and, Lord, even between you and others through us. So please, Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit and let him be active in speaking to our hearts. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The note-taking outline is available either in the lobby or online at the worship resources page, and I hope that you'll follow along if that's helpful. The words that go in the blanks on the sheet will be on the screens throughout the message. So the opening joke today, you can blame J-Man for this joke. He sent it to me, and when I read it, I laughed, and so I'm sharing it with you. Here we go. The king of Spain got a case of COVID-19 and was quarantined to his private jet. And that means the rain in Spain stays mainly on the plane. For those of you who have seen My Fair Lady, that makes sense. And if you never have, the rain in Spain stays mainly on the plane. It's not what the musical meant, but there you go. That joke really breaks the rules, doesn't it? Rules. The king rules. I know, he didn't have anything to do that day, the guy that thought it up. I'm going for king of the bad dad jokes. So if you want to nominate me, you have a whole bunch of material. Melchizedek was the king of Salem and priest of Most High God. And we're looking at him today. That's because Ruth Metro submitted this You Ask For It request. Who was Melchizedek in the Bible and what is his significance? Melchizedek is a mysterious figure. And I say that because we have very little about him in the Bible, and yet there's this huge claim that Jesus is a high priest in the order of Melchizedek. Melchizedek met and blessed Abram. He met and blessed Abram. Verse 18, then Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. He was priest of God Most High. So he met Abram. And what were the circumstances of this meeting? Here's what had happened earlier in chapter 14. Four kings in the land, in the area, and these were city kings. They're not kings of great big nations. These were kings of cities and their surrounding areas. Four kings, the king of Elam, the king of Goyim, the king of Shinar, and the king of Elisar, attacked Sodom and Gomorrah. And when they attacked Sodom and Gomorrah and took plunder from there, they captured Lot and his family. Lot is Abraham's nephew. And they took them with them. They took them to be servants or slaves. When Abram found out that Lot had been captured by these four kings, he mustered all of his servants, and the scripture tells us 318 of them, and he went after them. He chased them down, he engaged them, he defeated them in battle, recovered all the goods that they had taken as plunder, and rescued Lot and his family. That's what has just happened. As Abram comes back home from this victory, this military victory over the four kings, and from rescuing his nephew Lot, the king of Sodom comes out to thank him. That's the king of Lot's hometown. That's where Lot was living. And the king of Salem comes. Melchizedek, the king of Salem, appears without explanation. There's no foundation before, and there's no explanation after. Melchizedek, king of Salem, came, blessed Abram, brought bread and wine, blessed Abram, and disappears. And the only other reference to Melchizedek in the whole Old Testament is in Psalm 110, verse 4. The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. Now, Psalm 110 is written by David, and Psalm 110 starts with the claim, you are my son, today I've begotten you, and I'm going to make your enemies like a footstool under your feet. And so King David is prophesying in Psalm 110 about the coming Messiah. And in verse 4, he says, you are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. So we know that Melchizedek was the king of Salem. And by the way, Salem was a shortening of Jerusalem. His city-state that he was king of was actually Jerusalem, which was to become David's city and to become the capital of Israel and to become the holy city. And one day there'll be a new Jerusalem, and Jesus, the high priest in the order of Melchizedek, will reign there forever. He was the king of Salem, and he was also priest of the Most High God. In the Bible, there are only two or three people who are both a king and a priest. Those offices are usually separate. The priests were in Aaron's line. The kings were in David's line. But David himself acted as both a king and a priest. Melchizedek was both priest of the Most High God and king of Salem. And of course, Jesus is our great high priest, and he is king of kings and lord of lords. So he blessed Abram, Abram paid him a tithe, a tenth of all the goods he had recovered in this war with the four kings. And from the historical account, that's all we know about Melchizedek. Very, very skimpy information. However, Melchizedek is clearly, because of Psalm 110 verse 4, and because of what the New Testament says about him, Melchizedek is clearly a prefigure of Jesus. He points to Jesus, who is our great high priest and King of Kings. The book of Hebrews tells us more about Melchizedek. The book of Hebrews tells us more about Melchizedek. So we're going to go through some of the verses in Hebrews and look at what it tells us. Start with Hebrews 5, verses 1 through 6. Every high priest is selected from among the people and is appointed to represent the people in matters related to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. We're going to stop right there. Every high priest is called and installed by God to be a go-between between him and his people, to represent the people to God, to represent God to the people. He's appointed to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. Okay, now we'll go on. He is able to deal gently with those who are ignorant and are going astray, since he himself is subject to weakness. Every high priest ought to know human frailty because all the high priests were humans. This is why he has to offer sacrifices for his own sins as well as for the sins of the people. And no one takes this honor on himself, but he receives it when called by God, just as Aaron was. Every high priest is called and installed by God. In the same way, Christ did not take on himself the glory of becoming a high priest, but God said to him, "You are my son, today I have become your father." And he says in another place, "You are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek." You are my son. You are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. Those two quotes are right from Psalm 110, and they point back to this Psalm of David, which is looking forward to the Messiah. Melchizedek is the great high priest who has an order of priesthood that Jesus takes and Jesus fulfills. Jesus is a high priest like Melchizedek. All right, now, Hebrews 6:19 through 7:3 tells us some more. We have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. It enters the inner sanctuary behind the curtain. Now stop right there. What's he talking about? The sanctuary of the temple has a holy place where the people come and bring their sacrifices, an altar where the sacrifices are offered, a big curtain that separates the holy place from the Holy of Holies, the most holy place. And in the Holy of Holies, the most holy place behind the curtain, is the Ark of the Covenant of God, the mercy seat of God, where God sits above the law and is present with his people, but he's separated by a curtain. This hope we have in Jesus, goes behind the curtain into the holiest place, the Holy of Holies, to make intercession there. Let's go on. Where our forerunner, Jesus, has entered on our behalf. He has become a high priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. This Melchizedek was king of Salem and priest of God Most High. King of Salem, again, king of Jerusalem. By the way, it's king of Jerusalem. The word here in the Hebrew is shalom, and that means peace. So Melchizedek is king of peace and priest of the Most High God. Who is the Prince of Peace? Jesus. Who's going to be the King of Peace forever when he reigns forever as King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Jesus. Jesus will be the King of Salem, just as Melchizedek was. He met Abraham returning from the defeat of the kings and blessed him. And Abraham gave him a tenth of everything. First, the name Melchizedek means king of righteousness. That's what the Melchizedek means. Then also, king of Salem means king of peace, king of shalom. We just talked about that. Without father or mother, without genealogy, without beginning of days or end of life, resembling the Son of God, he remains a priest forever. So Hebrews says, because Melchizedek just shows up in the Old Testament, there's no genealogy assigned to him. We don't know who his father or mother was or his ancestry, and we don't know anything about the rest of his life and when he died. He's an eternal figure in the Old Testament. He's without beginning and end because most ever all the other historical figures in the Old Testament, they give the genealogy and the ancestry, and they talk about when they die, but not so with Melchizedek. And so, again, the Hebrews is using Melchizedek as a symbolism or a type of Jesus Christ. He's a priest forever. It's an eternal priesthood. It confirms that Melchizedek is the king of Salem and a priest of the Most High God. He's the king of righteousness and the king of peace. It's a big deal to the Jews. And Hebrews states Melchizedek resembles the Son of God. Did you hear that? He resembles the Son of God. And that's one of the reasons why Melchizedek remains a priest forever. Now, without quoting all the verses that are around in this chapter, the next argument Hebrews makes is that Melchizedek's priesthood is superior to the priesthood of Aaron. For one thing, it's way before the priesthood of Aaron. Melchizedek's priest of the Most High God is during Abraham's time. Aaron's priesthood doesn't start until way after the children of Israel have been in Egypt for 400 years and been in slavery, and that priesthood begins with Moses. So Melchizedek's priesthood predates Aaron's priesthood by several hundred years. The book of Hebrews says that Melchizedek's priesthood is superior to Aaron's because, first of all, Abram paid tithes to Melchizedek, and the one who receives the tithes is the superior one. The inferior person pays tithes to the superior person. We give our tithes to God Most High and to his work. Melchizedek's priesthood is superior to Aaron's because Melchizedek blessed Abram. Before Aaron was even alive, Melchizedek blessed the father of our faith. It's superior because all of the Aaronic priests, the priests of Aaron, were human beings who lived and died. Melchizedek has no beginning and no end. He has an eternal priesthood. And then Hebrews makes this kind of curious claim, and I see it, but I'm not sure why it's that significant. And that is, you could even say that Levi, the source of the Levitical priests, paid tithes to Melchizedek through Abram, because he was still in Abram's body when Abram paid the tithes to Melchizedek. You know, the DNA was there that eventually would be Levi. Melchizedek's priesthood surpasses the Levitical priesthood, the priesthood of Aaron. And therefore, Melchizedek points to our real high priest. Melchizedek points to our real high priest. And when we get to Hebrews chapter 9, verses 11 to 14, it gets to the meat of it. Hebrews 9, 11 to 14. But when Christ came as high priest of the good things that are now already here, he went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not made with human hands, that is to say, not a part of this creation. He did not enter by means of blood of goats and calves, but he entered the most holy place, the holiest of holies, once for all by his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption. The blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean sanctify them so they are outwardly clean. It takes care of their own disobediences, their own sins they have committed. How much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death so that we may serve the living God? The blood of Christ cleanses our consciences. The blood of Christ makes us new. And you notice it says cleanses our consciences. It doesn't say suppresses our consciences. It doesn't say soothes our conscience. It doesn't say calms our conscience. It doesn't say subdues our conscience. It says cleanses our conscience. Sets us free from the condemnation of our conscience. Why? Because the great high priest in the order of Melchizedek, Jesus Christ, didn't just go in behind the curtain in the temple in Jerusalem and make his sacrifice. He entered the actual holy place in heaven by his blood and made the sacrifice there on our behalf once for all. His sacrifice is enough. His sacrifice actually deals with sin, with the capital S, not just with our sins, our actions that we commit because we have a sin nature. Jesus is able to cleanse our conscience. Jesus is able to set us free. Jesus is able to purge the sin from us. And it takes the rest of our lives after we ask Jesus in our hearts for him to continue that purifying and continue making us holy and making us like himself. But he's able to do it. And the day will come when we will stand before him unblemished. We will stand before him completely purged of all sin. We will stand before him completely restored to the perfection that represented Adam and Eve before they fell. The very intention of God for who human beings are to be. We're going to stand there and the great high priest will pronounce us not guilty. Thanks be to God. So here's the bottom line. Jesus, our great high priest, is able to deliver us from sin. Jesus, our great high priest, the one who is after the order of Melchizedek, priest of God Most High and King of Peace, King of Salem, this Jesus is able to deliver us from sin. So I have a question. Do you suffer from guilt? Do you carry guilt around with you? Do you feel guilty? Do you feel unworthy? Do you feel trapped in a cycle of confessing your sin and asking God to forgive it and then going back and sinning again, the same sin over again and confessing God again and then having forgiveness and then going back and committing the same sin over again? Dozens of times, hundreds of times, trapped in a cycle of confession and forgiveness and recommitting that sin. Our great high priest, Jesus Christ, the order of Melchizedek, is able to forgive. He's able to break chains. He's able to set us free. He's able to deliver us from sin and death itself. Jesus, our great high priest, is able to deliver us from sin. Throw your life on his mercy. Don't plead, I'm a good person. Don't plead, I'm trying my best. Throw your life on his mercy. Receive his grace. And all will be forgiven. Nothing you have ever done is beyond his grace. Nothing you could ever do is beyond his grace. All will be forgiven because that great high priest, Jesus Christ, in the order of Melchizedek, went into the real Holy of Holies by his own blood and paid the price. Thanks be to God. Pray with me, please. Father, when we hear the real gospel and we understand what Jesus did for us, and what is available to us by faith, our hearts respond with a simple cry. I need that, and I'm not worthy. I need that, and I don't deserve it. God, that's why it's called grace. You give us this forgiveness. You give us the right standing of being restored to relationship with you by the blood of Jesus, and we don't deserve it. It's grace. You are able to forgive because Jesus paid the price. Your holiness and justice is satisfied because our sin is already paid for. And we receive the King of Peace. We don't have to live our lives guilty. We don't have to live our lives feeling unworthy. We don't have to live our lives trapped in a cycle of sinning and confessing and being forgiven and sinning again. You are able to deliver us by the blood of Jesus, our great high priest. So, Father, we throw our lives on your mercy. We give our lives to you because we have nothing else to give. And we trust Jesus. He is the author of our salvation. He is the one who died in my place. He is the one who can deliver me from sin. I trust Jesus. He is enough. So, Lord, set me free to joyful, victorious living. Help me be like Jesus. Help me love like Jesus. Help me serve like Jesus. And it will be enough. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I invite you to stand if you're able and sing our closing hymn.
All
Now, dear friends, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you all.